All right, my name is Al Olsen, and this is Rick Bellaire. We are interviewing Greg Abate today for the Rhode Island Music Hall of Fame at his home in Coventry, and today is the 30th of September. How you doing, Greg?
Good, good. Hi, Al.
How you doing?
I'm good.
So can you please tell us where you were born, when you were born, and a little bit about your family and neighborhood in Woonsocket?
I was born in Fall River in 1947. And my family is from Barrington, really, in Bristol. My parents moved to Woonsocket. My father was an x-ray technician at the hospital. So instead of making the commute every day, he found a house to rent right near the hospital. So moved there when I was about three. And I grew up in Woonsocket, went to the elementary school and junior high school and high school. Lived there till I went through college at Berkeley, commuting from Woonsocket too. Mm-hmm. First few years of college.
And were you involved in any formal music training while you were in the grammar school, middle school, high school?
Yeah, clarinet. First instrument was clarinet, and I took lessons from Henry Devist on Wall Street, and I also had Saturday morning lessons with group clarinets. It was pretty cool. It was about 35 kids. And remember, we put our 50 cents in a little bucket when we walked through the door, and we had an hour lesson with Henry Davis in the group.
For 50 cents?
Yeah.
Wow. Learning how to play ensemble.
Learning how to read, like, certain little rhythms and things like that. Mary Had a Little Lamb. Just still haven't mastered it, but I'm getting to it.
Your original introduction to the clarinet was through the school system, though.
Well, no, it was through the school system because it was a rental thing that happened. That, you know, I was in the den of my house. My mom was there ironing at the time. And this guy came to the door and knocked, and he had three instruments. And he had a trombone, and he had a trumpet and a clarinet. And he took them all out, and he demonstrated how they sounded. And I said, after he asked if he wanted to maybe study an instrument, and would you like to rent one of these? I said, yeah, I want to play the trombone. And my mom says, you're not playing that. You can play that one.
Why, she think it was too loud or not?
No, I don't know why her reasoning was. I never asked her, but, you know, she thought that I should play saxophone after, probably. She had a whole plan for me, maybe. I don't know. Hmm. But I like trombone. I like the sound of it. And I know that there's some trombonists out there doing what I do, but it seems like there's more saxophonists to me that are out there playing, soloing with different bands. Don't you agree?
Well, sure. Sure. Yeah. There's not that many famous guys. You got Al Gray and J.J. Johnson, and around here, Hal Cook is the band. But yeah, there's more frontmen.
I wonder why that is. I think it's because of the appeal of the instrument in a small group setting rather than a big band. Like
the saxophone you're talking about.
No, the trombone.
Trombone.
Yes, I think because of its timbre and its range, it's not necessarily, it's playing down the bottom. It's sort of like a baritone.
It is like a baritone.
You know?
Yeah.
So I think that's the difference. It doesn't have the melodic reach.
And that, speaking about baritone, like I play bari sax too, but there's more alto and tenor players than there are bari players playing solo. But that is a voice too. But you don't see that many compared to tenor and alto.
Same thing. Pepper Adams.
Yeah.
Ronnie Cooper.
There's
that's
more.
About it.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot. There's a lot more coming up, like Gary Smullyan, a lot of good, great players. But
Speaking of that,
Nick Brignola.
When you were younger, who were your musical influences, and how did you become aware of them?
Well, because of school at high school band in 1959, I think it was, I listened to Dave Brubeck's Take Five, and I was like, I liked the Paul Desmond tune Take Five. So everybody was playing that tune, trying to play that, you know. And so he was the first saxophone player that I really heard that was a professional, that was famous, you know. Mm-hmm. I didn't hear about all the other great ones until I got to Berkeley.
Had you already switched to the saxophone when you hit high school, or were you still on clarinet?
Yeah, I was in ninth grade, I started to play alto.
So when you were in grammar school and junior high, Or were you in playing with any ensembles other than the Saturday morning lessons? Was there a school band?
Oh, there was a school band all through junior high school, plus marching band.
You played at games and things like that? And
yeah, that wasn't my favorite thing to do. I kind of didn't like marching and doing that, but I had to do it, you know, because I just found it weird at that age to play music that way. I didn't know why, but it felt uncomfortable to me.
And what kind of songs did they teach you for marching band?
You know, Stars and Stripes, you know, a lot of Sousa things, which Sousa wrote some great he's a great march writer, of course. But I guess my heart wasn't into marching and playing an instrument at the same time. I didn't have any idea that I was going to play jazz, but I just didn't like that getting up and going and march. Plus, I'm not a sports guy, and I thought it was weird that people that played the music sitting on the bleachers were like not as important as the sports figures, and that pissed me off.
Interesting perspective.
And at that time, you know, you have the cheerleaders, which you might have had a crush on someone, but they didn't care about the musicians, they just cared about the football players. So we're talking about kids stuff, right? So I can come out and tell you that. I just remember all that stuff now.
That's good. So how were you exposed to jazz? Did that not come to Berkeley?
No, I played jazz in high school in the stage band.
Okay.
I played music, written music, but I wasn't an improviser then.
It was like a big band, stage band.
Yeah, you know, five saxes and four trumpets and three trombones and drums and maybe guitar, you know, so that was it.
The rhythm section.
Yeah.
So who was the conductor or the teacher?
Alfred Legue.
L-E-G-U-E?
L-A-G-U-E.
L-A-G-U-E.
Legue.
He was the music teacher.
He was the music director.
At Woodstock.
At junior high school.
Oh.
And then he went over to the high school.
Oh.
So I had him for like seven years.
Okay, so that's a big influence.
Yeah.
Did he give you any records or just sheet music?
Sheet music, yeah. And we played the record of Take Five. You know, we would play that and try to, you know, copy it and see how you could play the alto thing and the music to it so you can read it and that sort of thing. But I had no idea about the jazz soloing technique. I had no idea that what was going on other than that was ear playing, you know. Playing by ear.
We're almost up to Berkeley, but I have one more question about high school.
Sure.
Were you doing anything on the side, playing in a rock and roll band or anything like that during the high school, junior high period?
Yeah, I remember there's a place in Woonsocket called Shacktown. It's up in on Menden Road, you know, going up past like where, you know, if you know Woonsocket at
sure.
all? Yeah, it's, if you're going by the incinerator there, you keep going, you go away from Woonsocket, you keep going up, and when you get to the intersection of Menden Road and there is a place called, a little village called Shacktown. And there was a kid there that lived there that I played with. He was a guitar player, I can't remember his name. And then Russell Turner was the drummer in the high school band with me, junior high, late 9th, 10th grade. And we did a 45, I mentioned to you guys, it was on Main Street, this recording studio, one machine, and he pressed these 45s for people. So we recorded two sides of some song, which I have no idea what it was.
What was the name of the group?
Didn't have a name, I didn't think. I don't remember the name.
So they were probably acetates. He was cutting them on the spot, right?
That's right.
Yeah. So even if you had one, it probably wouldn't play anymore because you can only play those 10 or 12 times before they wear out.
Is that right?
Yeah, that's 45? Unfortunate.
Like the ones you used to get in the back of the cereal box.
Right, the ones they make for you.
This is a wax CD.
You actually had them pressed?
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Wow. Yeah.
We have to try to track this down here.
And was it rock
this would
and
be
roll,
your
or?
First recording, no matter what you think of it what it was.
Yeah, I would love to have it. You know, it's something about saving things, people.
Yeah, right.
You never
right.
know. Say, what is this? Oh, I don't need that.
There's
things that I have that I don't have that I should have remembered, like things back, you know, after that, like, not back before that, but after that, there's some things that I wish I had saved, you know, but I don't know where they are. Because I move around sometimes, you know, you live in a place for 10, 12 years.
Yeah.
And then you move and you don't
save right. stuff. Dust.
Start throwing stuff
we
out.
We have to try to find that out. I'll get back to that.
Yeah.
We need to. If it was pressed, then it was. The group must have met something in the area, at least the other guys that were
some
around.
Significance, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. That'd be worth it. Yeah. Well, let's move to Berkeley. All right. So, how did you end up going to Berkeley? And can you tell us any experiences of going to Berkeley?
Sure. Well, Berkeley was 1970, I think it was. But I went there out of. In January semester, because the fall semester, I went to Roger Williams College, Junior College. And I remember going there every day, driving to Providence, and it was kind of depressing, actually, going there, you know? Back of the YMCA building, and over there in Providence, that's where the college was.
In South Providence? Before Bristol, I guess. This,
yeah.
It was still a junior college, I guess,
yeah.
at that point, right?
And it was back near, and back near where the courthouse is now, you know, back there where they have I guess it's the jewelry district or something.
Okay, yeah. Yep.
Where, yeah, so I was there. But I didn't finish the semester there. I just quit because I didn't like the courses and I was kind of like bored with it, really.
So you weren't set on a path to be a musician yet?
No.
Even after high school graduation?
Yeah, I didn't know what I was going to do. So then I went and auditioned on clarinet for New England Conservatory, but I mentioned to you before that I didn't pass the audition. So then I ended up going to Berkeley. Someone said, well, you could go there. They'd probably like to have you there on saxophone. But I wasn't, you know, really inept at the saxophone to play the levels that I was there taking lessons with the level of teachers they had. But I did get accepted to go there, so that's when I started to play. You know, I can still feel the vibe of the old Berkeley School on Newbury Street, small brownstone, you know, with two buildings, and then when you practice, you had to practice clarinet, piano. They had piano rooms on Commonwealth Avenue where you had to walk all the way from Newbury Street to Commonwealth, and you went to this other extremely old building with the smell, you know what I mean? It's like the old smell. And you're in this room with this huge upright piano that's like kind of like, you know, kind of not new, and the whole vibe of it was incredible. I really really liked the time, you know. But then Berkeley was great because I was studying with jazz musicians that were players, you know.
Who were some of your instructors at Berkeley?
Phil Wilson, you know, Herb Pomeroy, and Andy McGee, Mike Rendish, Ray Santisi, John LaPorta, Dean Earl, you know, Charlie Mariano.
He was your applied instructor,
yeah.
Your sax instructor?
For one semester. Joe Viola was my name. Rod Furland. Rod still is, he lives in Massachusetts, I think in Sharon, Mass. He's still playing. He does a lot of work with the Pops and things like that. Roger Newman and Alf Clausen. Those guys I'll mention later, because I saw them when I moved to California, you know, in years after that, Berkeley. 4 years after I was at Berkeley, I moved to California.
Did you, before you left to go to California, mm-hmm. did you get exposed to any jazz by way of records, radio? Is that where you started to get turned on?
Yeah. At school, mm-hmm. listened to a lot of the, you know, the big bands, you know, all the, you know, Duke Ellington, Count Basie, you know, Buddy Rich, you know, Thad Jones.
The bop stuff too,
Jimmy,
right?
Jimmy Dorsey. Glenn Miller, you know, all the Stan Kenton, all this, there's so much to absorb, you know, to get a grasp on your own direction.
So was bebop popular yet at
yeah.
that point? And were they
not with me, no. But bebop was, that school was bebop. That was it. That was really, yeah, the 251, you know, that's the main, that's it, you know, that's my thing, you know, 251.
So the focus was on, I mean, you had ensembles, you had to play in bands and stuff, but the focus was on your individual performances.
No, actually, it was like, the focus was like studying your instrument, taking a piano class every semester, taking arranging and composition, and jazz, a history of jazz, counterpoint, ear training, harmony. Yeah.
So there wasn't really a lot of improvising as far as the school went.
As far as the curriculum.
Yeah, there was. If you were a good enough player, you could play in the jazz workshop. You know, I auditioned for that a few times, but I was never could make the grade because I wasn't, you know, I mentioned before that I wasn't really a good reader and improviser through the first few years of Berkeley. You know, because I don't know. I didn't study jazz in high school, really. I was playing classical music, you know, at my lessons. You know, I didn't do that. I'm a late starter, I think. You know.
Well, better late than ever.
Well, it worked out fine.
Yeah, I would say.
Yeah, late's good, but it's still never, no matter when you start or end it, it's still never, you never finish, no matter where you start.
Were you doing any gigging in college in Boston, or you were commuting, correct?
Yeah.
Between Boston and Woonsocket?
Yeah.
Did you do any gigging in Boston or back here in Rhode Island?
Yeah, I did a couple. Well, I was with a band in Rhode Island called the Stingers. You know.
The Stingers.
Yeah.
You had said Spinners. This might make a difference.
Ah,
the Stingers. Yeah, that's the Stingers.
Okay, well, this is great. Because I was trying to. You mentioned that those. Well, tell us a little bit about the Stingers.
Well, that was the group with Lenny Albanese, John Manzi on tenor, Jimmy Ryan on guitar. We had, did I leave the bass player? The piano player, I know his name, but I can't remember it. Tico somebody. He lived in Central Falls. He was from Poland, but his family's from Poland. And then we had the Johnson brothers, I believe, and those are the three young gentlemen that they died in a crash coming to a gig one night. And we were working up in Worcester somewhere, at the Knickerbocker Club or someplace like that.
Okay, you had mentioned going to Leominster.
That's it,
to
Leominster.
Fort Devens.
Fort Devens, oh, yeah, around there.
Good memory.
There used to be a night, the two Mohawk, nightclubs.
The Mohawk Club, that's the name of it.
At Fort Devens.
Around there, yeah.
Yes, there was. On the bass, so you weren't playing necessarily on the bass.
No.
Because the bass had two nightclubs, one for enlisted men and one for officers. But many of the personnel went into the surrounding towns to hit the bars, you know, of course.
It was a big blizzard that particular night. And of course, you got to come up 146, and that was the fatal thing.
So before... It was no 495 yet, right?
146 is still the way I go to Worcester. You know, I also played at the Canopy Club in Pawtucket. Yeah, that was great. Eddie's Canopy Club.
And what group would that be? The same group? The Stingers?
The Stingers, yeah.
So you were actually doing quite a bit in college.
Then I was with, do you remember the Lang's Bolarama?
Yes.
Yeah,
they had the club there, and I played there with a group that was a cover band for it. Like, we did Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and we did stuff like that.
Do you remember the name of that band?
No, I don't.
Can you remember anyone that was in the group?
Tony Georgiani.
Oh, okay.
Joe Georgiani.
Okay, both Georgiani brothers.
Yeah. I think Ed Valley was in that band, too.
Okay, I think I know where that's going, and I can check on this, maybe get the name. It was not Metropolis. That was, who were those
brothers?
That's
another band,
The Procaccini brothers ran Metropolis,
that's
right?
Awesome, yeah, I remember that name.
That was with Mike Kelly, Dave DiCenzo.
Right, exactly.
Arthur Coppola, the late great Arthur Coppola. Yeah. But there were a couple of other bands that had the horns, and the Georgiades band.
That was the one of
the Contenders, and you played with them.
Yeah, I think Bob Ryan was in that too. But then, of course, I played with Albie and the Spellbinders too.
Okay. Yeah.
That was another band, and then we played in Boston down, and then you know the.
That was before you went to California.
Yes.
Oh yeah. This is early Berkeley.
Earlier.
Yeah, before
early.
The break in your college. I would just like to mention, for the history, the great Albie Manfredi, who ran Albie and the Spellbinders for decades.
Yeah, yeah.
They were incredibly
friend.
Popular. He gave many musicians their start, and the Spellbinders are actually still in operation. They're still gigging. There's one original member. They've been together over 50 years.
Yeah.
Wow, gee, that's awesome.
So what was the break? I'm sorry?
Going to California. I was just trying to say that.
Okay.
How did you get to California?
There was a break in your education and you went out to California.
It was just a fluke thing. It was like a spontaneous question from someone that I was working with a band from California. They were both New Bedford natives. George Exafaris was the drummer, and he had a friend named Matthew Warget, who was a New Bedford guy, played baritone. And somehow he asked me to go to California, and they were putting a band together in Hollywood, and he says, "Are you interested to go?" And I said, "Yeah, I'll go." So, and then we got a trumpet player, Joe Andrea. He joined us, and then Steve Faber, who I just saw a couple of nights ago, actually, he lives in Framingham. He went. So the four of us, I think we went in, was it 65 Chevrolet Bellaire. We drove out there. We with the help of certain things. We left and got there exactly 3 days after we left from Fall River Mills. Huh. We drove from that parking lot and we took off, got there, and we started playing around Hollywood with this band. So,
how long did you take off from Berkeley?
Oh, about a year.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And is this when you got involved with Ray Charles? Is that after
No, this
Berkeley?
Is the second. That's the second.
That's
trip
the second
after
trip.
College.
Yeah. Okay. Second trip. Yeah.
Okay.
So, how about this? What made you decide I better go back home? It wasn't working. Yeah. I better get back home and finish school.
Well, you know, I'm not sure, but I know I missed home a lot, and I just felt like I don't know. I really can't answer that exactly. I still to this day don't know. Because I don't know if it's fate or what's supposed to happen, you know. But I came home because I was like wanted to come back, you know, and I went back and I guess I missed home. And I don't know, maybe I didn't like the lifestyle. It was kind of hard to make it, like to make enough money to live at that time. And I, you know, I was living with a bunch of people. You know, where did I... Oh, yeah, I know what happened. Yeah. I ended up getting married there.
Oh, that's important.
Oh, it was really, really a bad scene, though. But I remember being out there, and this woman was like, she was like about 13, 15 years older than I was, and I was just... 22 or something like that. And my father's sister lived in Long Beach, and she was the only one that didn't live around here. And I got to see her, visit with her quite a few times. And I told her I was getting married, and then she and her husband tried to talk me out of it. They just really went, "No, you shouldn't do this." And I said, "Oh no, I got it. This is great, you know." So then we got married, had a small wedding in Los Angeles at this little chapel thing, you know. Even the priest tried to talk me out of it. He did. No one could talk me out of it. Then we came back here together.
So, oh, that was my next question.
Okay. And I was so proud that I had this woman with me. I said, I with her and came back. And then my parents, they were blown away when they saw me come off the plane with her. I remember the look on their face. It was like, but you know, she wasn't very popular, although she's kind of like, you know, pretty cute. And she was really, she was just like a radical person, and they could tell she wasn't really going to be good for me, which she wasn't. But I mean, what I did was we rented an apartment on Diamond Hill Road, and I started going back to Berkeley, right? And I was going there, and I was, and she was doing work, working at a place, bagging Cheetos down in Cumberland on that road there that goes across the Bachman Company, right? And so, but she had a tendency to make me jealous a lot. You know, she was a lot older than I was, and I didn't understand the flirtatious thing, because, you know, I didn't know about it. So I decided, well, I'm gonna leave, I'm gonna quit, I'm gonna stop going to school. And she got me a gig at Bachman. So here I am going to Bachman, and I'm doing like putting Fritos in bags and stuff, stuff like that. And I just disappear. I just disappear at work, and they had the big warehouse with these huge boxes that went way up to the top of the ceiling, with about 10 feet between the boxes. And I climb up there, and I just crash out and take a nap. No one could find me, you know. But I do all this weird stuff. But we ended up getting divorced later. But she took off, and I never saw her again. And then I went back to Berkeley again. And sort of went, and then after that, I left and went back to California. I said, let me go back to California. You know, it's all this sporadic stuff. Man, it's like playing a solo, you know? you know, I'm just going to go with the feel.
So once you completed your studies at Berkeley, you did not have a gig in the wing. You went back to California to see what would happen?
Right.
See what would develop?
Yeah, okay. And somehow when I got off at the airport, I didn't really have a place to, I didn't have anywhere to go. I didn't know what the hell, I said, I'm here, but I don't know what, you know, that was really bold, man. I can't believe I did that. But somehow, I don't know if they say that there's angels watching over you. Who knows, right? But somebody asked me, so we got a house, we play music, it's me and the three other guys and that are musicians, and then there's two other guys that aren't musicians, but they live with us, and we have a big like place in Santa Monica, right off Bundy Drive. And so would you want to come and crash there for a while until you see what's going on? And I did. And then I started working with Dave Clark, the Dave Clark Expedition, where I got a gig with this. I went to this club one night, and I actually sat in, and there was the trumpet player and his family, a heavy Christian family, beautiful people. They actually took me in for a while too afterwards, and I went back to the apartment, and I went back and forth like with the guys, and they were kind of dragged that I had lost the gig. And they, you know, make a long story short, I didn't have any money to like contribute to the household, so they finally said, well, you know, if you don't get a gig, you know, you really shouldn't keep hanging out. Although they liked me, but they said, you know. So I went and I saw that the union that Ray Charles was having auditions for a new band. And I was kind of bold enough to go, and I went to the audition, and I got after 3 or 4 days, I got the job playing lead alto with Ray. So that's how that started.
I remember a little
story. Yeah, me too, yeah.
You went 3 or 4 days, and they said, oh, come back again.
Yeah, it was every day. They call up. Actually, they would really call. You know, like you say, when people say to you, you might have experienced this, oh, I'll call you tomorrow. I really liked what you did. And then you wait for the call, and it never comes, and you say, well, let me call them, and you can't reach the person. This was totally the other way. It was like they called every morning, and I made sure I was near the phone. And I was just waiting for that phone to ring, and he didn't come back, and he'd come back. And then the third time, I said it was like I needed to talk to Mr. Charles, because I've been here this is my fourth day now, and I can't go another. It's like, it's really nerve-wracking. I mean, I need to get the job, and I love to work in the band. It's like, really, it'd be an honor, you know? So they took me up to see Ray in his office, and he asked me to come in, and I just came out and said, you know, I've been here, you know, 4 days, Mr. Charles. And he says, yeah, I like your sound, Greg. Yeah, you want to do the gig? You think you can do it? I said, yeah, I can do it. You know, he says, okay, you got the gig. So that was it. So that took a lot of endurance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How'd it make you feel that you got the gig?
Oh, it was really cool. Yeah.
And this was a 2-year full-time gig. Now,
yeah, it was mostly on the road, yeah, in Europe and stuff, in America and Japan, and like, you know.
Basically touring the whole world, right?
Well, I didn't go to every country, but I went to every European country, and I went to, actually, it was when Berlin had the wall still. We played on both sides of the Red Curtain.
Wow.
What was it like playing on the other side?
At that time, it was kind of scary in a way, if that's a good term.
Sure.
Because we walked in a lot of different tunnels and stuff with the band sometime, and you could hear foot soldiers coming the other way, and they were carrying guns and stuff like that. And they weren't very friendly, but they knew that we were there for music, and we had a permit to be there. I guess that's how it works. And, you know, the music, though, when you're playing the music, there's no curtain at all. It's just straight on, you know. No one thinks, oh, well, they're American, we don't like them, you know. It's like music is a bond between humanity, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a beloved
character,
a superstar all over the world.
Yeah.
International. Yeah. Now, there was a story I remember you mentioning where you went to somebody's home to get some tips, but it didn't work out that way.
Oh, yeah, remember that?
Yeah.
At the audition, yeah, when I was there. And also, at the audition, in one of the first day, and then I mentioned my two teachers at Berkeley, I said, I'd bring their names up again, Al Clausen and Roger Newman were writers for Ray. They wrote charts, as well as Quincy Jones did, and Bill Holman, and all these great writers. And they saw me in the section, and they were surprised to see me there, and congratulated me to be there. They were surprised. Because I really wasn't a good reader at Berkeley. I couldn't read. But the other thing I mentioned before is, like, when I got in the section and started to read, I felt like I could read pretty well. It just was like a miracle type thing that happened, you know.
And there was a fellow who invited you to his house?
Yeah, he was in the band years before. Uh-huh. And he wanted to get the gig, I guess. But he didn't really sit down to audition, because at that time, Ray had already given me the gig, so there was no other audition for my chair. But he said he wanted me, he would help me out with some of the music, you know, and I said, well, that'd be great, but I didn't really know I needed help, because I was doing okay as it was. But he said he could give me some tips on stuff, which I went over there. I don't know why I did that, but I did. And he when I got there, he started to berate me, saying that what's wrong with me, white boy, this and that.
And just for the record, it was not any of Ray's famous, beloved
replays.
It wasn't Fathead Newman or any of those guys.
Yeah.
It was
somebody
who had been in the section.
Yeah, it wasn't anybody famous, someone that stuck out as one of the good guys, that all the guys in that band were so cool to me. You know, we were, you know, I was pretty much the youngest guy in the band, with one of the trumpet player and one of the trombone players. And we, you know, we were there, and we were embraced by everybody.
And Ray supported you in that argument.
Oh, yeah, Ray supported me. He said, I told Ray Charles about that, and he was really pissed off. He said, I know that guy. He says, I'll never, you know, I'm going to give him a piece of my mind when I see him for doing that to my musicians. Mm.
Still on Ray Charles?
Sure, Japan.
Yeah.
No, I was going to ask about, we could go there, but
okay.
I was going to ask about recording.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes, yeah, yeah.
We had talked about it,
mm-hmm.
and You think you identified a session or two.
Right, that's right. Important.
Can you remember anything else about the experience?
With the recording?
Yeah.
No, it's just, it was a two-day session, but I think that I heard that only one tune got on the record, which is Louise. Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, I did find a copy of the album while we were together last time. It has come. It came last night.
Yeah.
There are no credits on the album.
Ah.
Which is,
historical records hold that it was Greg Abate playing.
Well, I can see if I can tell my sound, though. I think I would be able to know.
Well, you recognized it.
I had found just the cut, Louise.
Yeah, that's the one.
But it's a whole album. It's on LP, so I'm hoping in the not too distant future I will make a digital transfer and send you a CD, and maybe you can go through the CD and identify any other tracks.
Sure.
Because I'm thinking, this is kind of an aside, but Ray had his own recording studio and his own record company.
It was really posh. It was nice.
I can't see him, if he had a great working band, why would he start hiring guys to make? You know,
that is interesting. Yeah, that would be a Ray Charles study.
Right.
What do you mean? Rather than,
if he was recording, he would have used his band.
Right.
Instead
that's what
of hiring other guys.
Yeah, he did.
This is an entire album from 74.
I recorded. It was a whole day of recording, and then the next day, I think we went back to do some more, too.
Well, I think maybe more, hopefully, we can figure out that more of it than Louise.
I played a lot on that record, on that session.
Okay.
Playing lead. I didn't play any solos, though.
In terms of performance, do you remember any like outstanding experience while performing with Ray Charles? Or just,
oh yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm a pretty sensitive guy, but I mean, I'm an emotional type person. I feel a lot of stuff. Like maybe you guys do too, right? I don't know how you are, but I mean, I'd be playing in the section. So Ray was usually right close to the saxes, you know, with the piano. So I'd always be picking up on, you know, everything, you know, I could see what he's doing and what he was meaning to do and, you know, how he was. So it was always a very goosebumps. I'd play and I'd be like feeling like, wow, this vibe's a good, what a vibe on the guy.
Did he ever play his alto?
Yeah.
When you were with him?
Yeah.
Ray Charles played alto?
He played blues, man. He stood up and he played a blues when he had other people playing. A guest piano player. I think he had Oscar Peterson. We were in England, and Joe Pass and Oscar Peterson were on the bill too, in London Hall there.
Royal Albert Hall.
Yeah, wow. And we were there, but Oscar opened up for us, for Ray.
Wow.
And then Ray invited Oscar to play, and he come up and played the blues, and Ray played his alto.
Wow.
Yeah. Joe Pass was on that too, but he didn't play with us. He just invited Oscar.
They were doing a lot of duo and trio things at that time with, can never remember his name, Neil Orsted Henning Pedersen.
That's him.
I think that's him.
He was a nice guy.
Not a trio.
Boy.
Drumless trio.
So in London doing that. Yeah. So Carnegie Hall, I played with Ray there. And I remember him playing America. That was great.
Yes, he had a recording of a recent recording. You didn't play on America, did you?
Well, I played the tune with him.
No, I mean the recording.
I might have been in the session, if it's on that record. I was in the session.
It's not on that album.
No.
So that was released well before it became a popular thing, like late in the 80s.
Yes.
It had been to the 80s.
Yes. Yeah, well, it had been around. I'll get a date on America. Mm-hmm. But you did play the chart with him in person.
Many times. Yeah. Fool on the Hill.
Fool on the Hill, too, with the Beatles cover.
Eleanor Rigby.
Wow. Yeah, he did a lot. I know the album. It had a white cover. But I think that album predates your tenure with the band.
Yeah.
And America comes from an album called Abraham, Martin, and John, which also predates your...
But you performed on those numbers.
Yeah, it was fun. A lot of stuff.
So, how'd you get out of that? I mean, why did you stick around for the rest of your life?
Well, it's women things again. Like, you know, I was like young, right? Younger. Yeah. You know, I'm thinking about young, right? I mean, like, I'm playing a gig last week in Methuen, and somebody comes up to me and they bring me up my first my Live at Birdland album, 1991. They said, "Hey, look what I got. Will you sign for me?" And he still had. I said, "Look, look who's this young guy in the photo?" I said, "What do you mean, a young guy? I'm the same person.
Yeah.
I don't see myself any different." You know. So I mean, but well, how did I get into that? Oh yeah, because I was young, right? I thought I was younger. I was in my 20s. But I had met. I'm like, you know, come back to L.A. from the tours, and we go back and play and come back. You know, it was always nice to come home. But I met this really nice young lady at the Air Force Base in Montgomery, Alabama, and she was here. Her father was a lieutenant colonel in the Air Force, and this particular family was in the front row and around the big round table at the Air Force Base hall we played at, and we had eye contact, and then I walked off on the intermission and went right to the table right up there, and I had to meet her, you know, and her father looked at me really kind of strangely because I had long hair down on my shoulders and a huge beard. I was like haired out, man. But we hooked up. So she lived in Balboa Beach in the Hollywood area. And so we started to get together, Dave, and then we started living together. And then I went back on the road, and I was starting to miss her. And all the guys, a lot of the older guys that wanted to come home for some reason, they would do something to upset Ray, and Ray would fire him and he'd send him home. So I said, "Well, let me try something." I said, "I got to try." And I was really... I think I did an injustice to Ray to try to do that. But, you know, women can make you crazy, you know. But this woman is the mother of my daughter.
Right.
Yeah.
That's the story you were going to... You should tell that story again.
But my daughter, you know, I mean, I'm glad that this all happened. I mean, daughter's like, you know, great. And we still... Her mom is a real good mom. And the family still... We still... You know, I play in Arizona. I go up there a lot and her grandmother lives there. At first, her grandmother didn't like me, her grandma, because I guess she came to see us when we lived in Mohegan, Rhode Island, when I was playing gigs around here. We lived in Mohegan in a cabin. And her mother said, "What are you going to do? How are you going to support my daughter and stuff? When are you going to get a house?" And I said to her, I remember, "Don't worry. We can live in a cave. It doesn't matter."
Wow. That worked.
That did it. That really clinched our relationship. But now, she has the utmost respect for me for what I've done. You know, she can't. She's like almost my mother. Like, you know,
yeah, mothers will do that.
But so, you were missing your wife and wanted to. The old guys told you,
right,
get yourself fired.
Get yourself fired. Like right.
And what did you do?
I was in the section. And we were in Japan, and I was in there. A lot of times when the reeds get soft, you could put a quarter up against the mouthpiece. No, the reed. So you don't put the quarter in the mouth. Take the reed off the mouthpiece, put the quarter on it, and then you can light the reed, and it burns the edge of it off. So I thought, well, maybe I should just light a reed and let it burn, and maybe that would get me fired. So I'm embarrassed to say that is a dumb thing I did. And then at the end of the performance, the manager came up to me and said, "Mr. Charles would like to see you in his suite." And I said, "Oh, well, okay. I'll go." You know, I go up there now. He says, "Yeah, go right up there." We're in the Tokyo Osaka Hotel or someplace. Huge place. And I went up the elevator, 35 floors or something, and I knock on the door. And the guy answers, "It's not." And Ray yelled to come in. And Ray's walking down the hallway. It's kind of a big suite he had. And he had, I remember, the red robe, and he had his glasses on. He had a bathrobe on. He's walking in his hands. "Hi, Greg, how you doing, man?" I said, "Oh, good, Mr. Charles, I'm good. Would you want to see me?" He says, "Yeah." He says, I want to give you a raise." I said, "Oh, man, what, really?" He says, "Yeah." He says, "It was quite substantial per week, like $50 more." And he says, "You know, I know you want to go home," but I said, "You know, I instead of me getting upset, I said, you know, I know you're young or whatever, you want to go home, but I want you to stay. You'll be better off. Trust me." He says, "Oh, you know," he says, "you get back home sometime, you know." So he was really nice about it, you know.
So you were still in?
Still in.
Yeah.
But when you got home, you must have left the band, right?
Yeah.
Because now it's 2 years.
Yeah, I got back.
You gave me notice.
Yeah.
You gave your notice.
Yeah.
For the girl.
Yeah. Wow. That was a little while. And then she's...
So we're now at 76 or 77?
No, 75.
All right, 74, 75 was the...
Yeah, 73 and 74.
73, all right, so we're at the beginning of 75.
Yeah.
I have a five-year gap in my knowledge here. I pick you up in the late 70s.
Right.
With the original Channel 1, and you had started work at the movies.
Right, exactly, that's right.
Big band. So what happened between 75 and 78 or 79?
I was working with Bobby Shannon in the group at the El Toro.
Oh, in the outside of Woodstock.
Forestdale.
Forestdale, yeah.
Yeah. I lived in Mohegan in a cabin, and it was kind of, I had two dogs, a big German, I had a St. Bernard that I adopted.
Wow.
And I had another dog that we had in California. We flew him in. We flew the dog in, so we got two dogs, and then we had Jessica, you know, our daughter, and then was playing at this place six nights a week.
I would like to insert here, for Al's benefit and for those of you too young to remember, the El Toro was a major night spot.
I've heard of it.
In Forestdale, village of Forestdale, outside of Woonsocket. They had two rooms, and they were one of the last clubs to really run six or seven nights a week, often with two acts. Do you remember the stage?
Definitely.
It had a, like in a theater, where the band would be set up and they would raise you into the, stage.
That's,
it was
cool.
A big,
yeah.
It used to be like a supper club, but they had stayed with the,
yeah,
times. And
right, yeah.
They were having show bands that played rock and roll and R&B and, you know, into the disco era.
Yeah, it was a dance band. It was, you know, we played all this. You know, Bobby Shannon was a vocalist, and we had another sax player. We had a drummer, guitar player, and a bass player.
What was it, just the Bobby Shannon Review or something like that, or did it, the band
Bobby
have a
Shannon
name?
Just, Bobby Shannon.
It was just Bobby Shannon, the,
yeah,
star.
Yeah, and he used to work at the hotel in Woonsocket that burnt down. I can't remember. It was across from Chan's around there.
Oh, yeah.
And they have there's a big open space there now.
Right.
Yeah.
That was a major hotel,
yeah,
back
was,
in the,
yeah,
day.
Yeah.
And, yeah, that was your main gig?
Yeah.
Playing with Bobby,
yeah,
Shannon.
Yeah, we do like functions on the afternoon on Saturdays and Sundays, and had that. So it was a pretty good lucrative gig to have at the time.
Hmm.
Yeah.
So that fills,
that time.
Fills up the gap?
Yes, pretty much.
Yeah, that one night I had gone, well, what happened for that band is, like, I was kind of an introvert at that. I was mostly an introverted person then. I was like, kind of like young and stupid, I think, a lot of times, you know. And but I would be, you know, I wasn't very sociable. You'd never know it, right? But I didn't like to talk to people. I didn't do, and that went on for a while. But I remember playing New Year's Eve with the band, and somebody asked me to play something, and I didn't want to play it. So what I did, I was with Bobby Shannon, I started to play like Ornette Coleman. I started to blow my horn into the guy. I was doing all this. I say Ornette Coleman, not that I played like him, but it was something that was atonal. And at the end of the night, I got fired. And I was like, they let me go. And so then I had no gig again. And I went, I was like looking, I went to Allery's one night, and the Vipers were there. And they asked me to sit in. It wasn't Young Neil and the Vipers, it was just called the Vipers.
And he,
Bobby Enos was in it, the trumpet player.
Okay, who wound,
like,
up in Room Full, yes.
Right, and then he was there, and there was Jake Kahn and Leroy White, and the drummer who was there for a while, and then he left, and another drummer came in, and Paul Del Nero on bass.
Okay.
And they also played at Harpo's on Wednesdays, and then they played at Allery's on Thursdays. So I joined the band after what. So I was in. Was Arthur Manchester was in that band too, the sax player. He's still in Newport and he does a lot of things. So it was Arthur, me, and Bobby on the horns, and then we had the rhythm section. Paul Murphy was joined the band,
okay,
later.
Murphy played too.
Yeah. So that band, turned into Channel One, because I was writing music, and I'd bring in a chart, and it was like, you know, we'd be doing like Lambrix, Hendrix, and Ross tunes, and then we'd do a Greg Abate tune, and then I started bringing more music in, and the band evolved into a more of a modern day fusion band, and then some of the players left because they weren't able to play that music, and we got other guys that could do it, and we had a pretty good band.
Well, just for the record, for people who are too young to remember Channel One, Channel One really took Rhode Island and Southern New England by storm. You know, the fusion was starting to really hit the mainstream. I mean, there was a point where Mahavishnu Orchestra and Return of Forever would play at the Civic Center.
Oh, so this is the fusion thing we were referring to.
But no one around here was doing it. The Vipers were very similar to Hamilton Bates' Blue Flames. It was more of a straight-ahead
rock and blues band.
Yeah, and you know,
New Orleans.
Yeah,
New Orleans.
Yeah, that kind of thing. But no one was really playing fusion at that time until Channel One.
You did Fats Waller tunes.
Yeah, right. Right.
Great stuff. It was a good education. Yeah, it's like so much. I would, you know, I really hope that other musicians can have such a vast history of education that I have.
Wow.
But there's a thing with Channel One, you guys may not know this, but I forgot to mention before to you, I think. But we had, there was this, an agent from New York that got us hooked up with Teo Macero.
Yeah.
And we went, Teo did a record for us.
For the record again, Tio producer was Tio Nacero was a staff producer at Columbia Records. Mm. His principal client was Miles Davis.
Ooh.
He produced Miles Davis during his entire, basically for his entire Columbia career, including Into the Fusion Era with Pitches Blue and
really,
yeah.
So that's
the Fillmore and On the Corner, all that stuff.
Kind of blue all the way through there.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
Sketches of Spain.
Yep.
Wow.
Yeah, I listened to that a lot.
So he knew the band, Teo Macero.
Well, he produced a record for us. We did it. I have it's on tape, but I haven't got it pressed. And it's like some stuff we did, man. He liked it, and the record company wanted to do something with us. And for some reason, we were stubborn with the terms, and we declined. Stupid, real stupid. We declined. And Howie, the manager, says, "Man, you guys, you drive a hard bargain." But you got a chance. I had no idea of the history of what I was dealing with.
He was still working for Columbia, I assume.
Yeah.
Which means he was doing it as a representative of Columbia, and the deal was probably for Columbia Records.
He was trying to help us. But he produced the record, like, musically. He would be there giving ideas and stuff like that. And I'm surprised. I had no idea that it was so heavy, you know. Unbelievable.
As I recall, doing some research in Texas, Doug Sum, for example, got 1 penny royalty per play, you know, via ASCAP or BMI.
What year was that?
That would have been 65, 66.
But that, you know, that by then, this was an album album market
rather than a single
albums
market.
Were driving the record business economy, so that's how people like Miles Davis could have hit albums and make millions of dollars and get gold albums just because the album was the thing. They weren't worried about the singles, and
they didn't have the internet there either. They didn't have internet downloads and all that, huh?
No.
You had to listen to
the whole record or listen to the radio until your song came on.
And the other thing that was happening was most of your venues, your colleges and your hipper venues like the Fillmores and stuff, they would book, say, a rock band, you know, the Allman Brothers, but they would put them with B.B. King and Roland Kirk. You know, they would have a diverse bill, so there was a lot of work for, and that drew record sales for the jazz acts.
Mm-hmm.
So I assume that's what led you to record the Channel One album on your own label.
I made up that label, you know, it was just something to put on the record, but it didn't get distributed, you know. It was just a local album we had pressed, and we paid back the guy that produced it all the money, that he paid for the session at Normandy Sound. Phil Green did the recording for us, and that was I still have some copies left. I mean, I'm sure you have one, right?
Oh yeah.
I'll take one.
All right. And you also gave me a copy. He had it transferred to CD. Gave me that. It actually did sell well. You used to sell it on your gigs.
Yeah.
And it was in stores.
It was.
It was in the local.
I'd go to when stores would take albums on consignment and stuff. That was good. I actually sold quite a few of those.
I wasn't
thinking it's still pressing them off. But, I listened to it, and it really is a special thing of feeling of, what's the word? Just...
youthful joy?
Yeah, it's not what, sympathetic? Is it sympathetic? Not sympathetic.
Empathetic?
Empathetic. It's like you can hear the rawness in it, But it wasn't really developed, but the tunes, people like the tunes, they're really kind of... melodic and all that, a lot of people like Channel One.
It's a great album, no matter what he says.
Check it out.
For a bunch of young guys working on their own, and they're mostly your tunes, I believe.
Yeah.
Were they any of the same tunes you recorded for Columbia?
No, there's a whole different stuff.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
I hope you can find that.
Demo
tape will have that digitized for posterity. Oh, sure. Yeah.
No kidding.
We just got a reel-to-reel
to
help us transfer. Yeah. So
I know how to use one of those.
How about if I give you the tapes I have and you can see what's on them? And I can tell you what they are, but I haven't got a tape player.
Right. Yeah. Well, it'll take a while, but yes, that's one of our... part of our mission is to get this stuff digitized, so they'll be preserved forever.
So let's go beyond that.
I've got some things. I recorded a CD, a recording that was produced. I produced it myself with Dick Johnson at Celebration Sounds. It's a real nice recording, but it never got out anywhere, And we also did something at Chan's. It's a live recording for 2 nights. It was recorded on 2-inch tape, I think. But that was so much stuff is going on that I can't always remember it, and it's coming back to me. I'm bad with writing a resume.
CRS is my father.
Where were you about to head?
Wherever we could go beyond the Channel One.
Okay, I wanted to only revisit the fact that he was playing at the Bovies Big Band Monday night with the Duke Bellaire.
Okay.
And you're on that recording too.
Yeah,
recorded one album, but he's featured on it.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm in the section. I didn't take any solos on it.
Huh.
Your picture's on it.
Yeah. And also, I played with Tony Giorgiani's Sax Odyssey Band.
Right.
That was great. That's the Engine Company in Providence. Yeah. That was very, very good, man. I wrote a lot of charts for that too. I remember I did a chart on Chameleon once.
And Herbie Hancock's song.
And there's no word of a lie here, but the chart was I think it was 12 pages long on each part. And I did it all by hand.
Wow.
And every chorus, every section, I reharmonized Chameleon. So it would be all, every tune, every part of the melody would be harmonized differently.
Every chorus that repeated was a different harmonization than the previous appearance. Wow.
Yeah, it was really interesting. I had tunes like Neptune and stuff like that, really out stuff, and it was really fun to write for that man. The music was hard.
You have recorded Neptune. Is on one of your albums? Isn't it?
No, Andromeda's on.
Oh, that's it.
Andromeda.
I
you
mentioned
that.
Space
right.
thing, yeah.
Space. The final.
So now we are in approximately 1981. All right.
So, take us, if you could give us a synopsis of.
Well, that's what I did Channel One at the celebration, the Channel One LP.
Right. But within a year or so, Channel One was gone. Right?
82.
Oh yeah. Oh, that's a good time for a break. Let's hit the pause button.
Fusion group led by Greg Abate, and the album just came out in 1981. The group lasted another year and a half or 2 years. They're very popular, I can attest to that. But you were all doing other gigs. You weren't making a living off Channel One, even though you were very popular. You were doing other kinds of gigs, like GB things.
Yeah, and bouncing around, doing different things when we could. Yes, yeah. It was like a this, I guess. What's the word? Different things.
Yeah, a co-op is where you could all go off and do your own things and come back together and be Channel One.
Right. We'd have steady things we do, and other things we did on our own. You know, someone would want to. Saxophone player for something, and they call me, we do this, and general business. Did a lot of that.
So now, Channel One calls it a day in 1983.
Mm-hmm.
Your first major label record came out in 1990 or 91.
1990.
What were you doing from the end of Channel One until the first Candid album?
Good question.
Well, it's 6-7 years.
Well, I sort of like was it, I was doing Bovies still. I was living on the Cape. Oh, I was off the Cape, I think, because I had gone into a hospital for a month, and I got back out, and I was just like living at my folks' house. Kind of just thinking about what to do. And I was playing at Bovies on and off, and I was still doing general business. I was doing gigs with people on the Cape or in Boston, like, or doing a private party or something like that. Put together little quartets and just whatever came up. And I was teaching a lot. I was doing private students. I was renting a studio at Roberts Music.
In Pawtucket?
No, Smithfield.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, they moved to Florida now. They live in Jacksonville. But Robert's Music is still, the name was bought by other people that do it now.
Right, they're heavy into band instruments and rentals, the same way you got started.
Right.
There's still a music program in a few schools where kids need to
rent
horns.
Yeah, you got to start with that. And those intermediate horns work good.
When... we could be skipping ahead, but when did you start your association with Rhode Island College?
1999.
Okay, so that's
further on.
We're not there yet. So you were mainly teaching privately at Roberts Music and...
Yes. Yeah, Roberts Music, I was teaching privately. And also, in 1985, I was still teaching... And I was still playing with the Bovies band. And that's when Dick Johnson formed the New Artie Shaw band.
Okay, I can't believe I blanked on this. He spent 2 years with Artie Shaw.
Artie Shaw, that's right.
I have questions there.
Yeah.
Okay, so do you want to tell the story of how Dick got involved?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, Dick and his manager, Bill Curtis at the time, and a fluke said, you know, because Artie Shaw was one of Dick's favorite clarinet players of all time. And so Dick said, let's send Artie Shaw one of the CDs you just did, one of your recordings. And so they sent it to him. And Dick told the story is that Artie Shaw called back and said, man, I said, I haven't heard a clarinet player like that in a long time. He says, you sound great. I'd love you to lead my new band. And Dick was floored. Rightly so. And he did it. And he put together all these guys, including me. I joined in 86 because the band started in 85. And I was kind of disappointed that he didn't ask me to play right off. But, you know, he knew. I guess he had other people in mind.
He had guys, including some of his old guys, when he reformed the band. And that's that's an important point. At the beginning, it wasn't just a legacy band. You know what a legacy band is?
It's not. It's legacy because Artie's still alive.
Artie was still there and involved. See, there's still a Glenn Miller band, an official band.
And that would be a legacy band.
Yes. Okay. In fact, there's still a Ray Charles legacy band led by a Rhode Islander, the great Billy Osborne from LTD, Jeffrey's brother.
Excellent.
They still play. They're not getting that many calls, but there is an official Ray Charles Orchestra. So it was not a legacy band. Artie was involved.
Still in the band.
And when there was an opening.
Well, Dick asked me to play tenor saxophone in 1986, and I played for 2 years until 1988 about. And then, we did mostly on the United States, a lot of touring on the bus. And then we went on a cruise. We did the Royal Viking Sea down the Mediterranean through the Panama Canal and all that. And see, and then Artie Shaw on the rehearsals was he auditioned the band, all us guys again in Boston in 1986, and we were there. Carol Sloan's husband Buck Spiro was there, and they came and listened. And at the time, there was a vocalist auditioning too, and Artie had decided that he didn't want to have a vocalist anymore, so went all instrumental at that point. And we'd be on the road, and people would come up to Dick saying, "Gee, where's the vocalist?" And he'd say, "Well, you know, Artie Shaw decided against it. He wanted to go all instrumental." He said, "Gee, well, you think you'll ever have a vocalist? You know, the band sounds kind of better with a vocalist." And Dick says, "Well, you know, Artie's the boss, you know." And I said, "Well, can't you talk to him?" And he said, and Dick said, "Look, you started off good, but you got to stop now." So that was the end of that. But we'd be in Disneyland. We did Disneyland two or three times, and we did 6 nights in Anaheim. And we'd be there playing in the Cinderella room or outside the ballroom. What a nice vibe it was, you know. And then one night, a couple times, Artie would come himself and sit in the audience. And he'd have a long trench coat on, brown, and a hat that would cover his face with the brim. And he'd sit there, and like people are dancing to his music, like great dancers. And we'd be cutting up saying, "Look, he's Artie sitting right there, and they don't even know it. There's arm length away from him." And if they knew that their idol was sitting there, they probably would freak out. So that was another thing. He did quirky things like that.
Did he ever appear with the band?
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought so, yeah.
He didn't play, but we did a lot of things, especially in the big, like the theaters where we did, like these summer outdoor theaters like Tanglewood or, you know, the Cape Cod Melody Tent. We would back up great. We did Rosemary Clooney, got to know her. We played behind her. Tony Bennett, we went out for dinner with Tony in Philadelphia. We did a week with Tony, and then Vic Damone and Mel Torme. So I get to work with all these vocalists for a week, you know, and hang out with them in the dressing room and stuff like that, with Artie Shaw. So I call it the Artie Shaw Dick Johnson School of Music. So I call it the Ray Charles School of Music. I call it Berklee School of Music. But the real education came when I left Berklee and went, did all this, a lot of dues. You know, business too.
Had you played tenor before that gig?
Yeah, I played tenor with Channel One.
Right, and flute.
Yeah.
Yeah, we didn't talk about adding the tenor and the flute.
Well, I played tenor, flute, soprano, baritone, and alto. But I learned flute when I was with the Ray Charles Band, because I told you that I had a flute parts in my book, but I didn't have a flute, and I had to go. I bought a Yamaha student model flute, and I practiced like a lot to get to play it, and I wasn't very good at it, but James Clay would play the flute parts for me, and at the time he didn't have to play his tenor, so it worked out. Ray didn't seem to care, but he didn't probably know it. He probably knew it, but he didn't say anything.
And the tenor, when did that come into your
purview? Well, in 1978.
Oh, okay. Early on.
Yeah.
Doubling on tenor.
Oh, yeah. I like tenor. I like playing all the horns. They're all my favorites when I play them. When it's the soprano, that's it. So now I'm lucky to have that. You know, I'm saying that because it's true. It's fortunate to have that. So it's not like playing the alto and the soprano. It's a different mindset altogether.
Were the Artie Shore charts any of the actual out of his original book from the 30s and 40s?
Yep.
Wow, that must have been pretty heavy.
Yeah. The only thing is the interpretation is different because we played it kind of, we didn't try to copy the vibrato and copy this, but we did kind of like make it a little bit step above in the tradition of the music. Because, you know, like the great saxophone players from Dixieland on, you know, starting, like, one of my favorites is Benny Carter, you know, but when Benny Carter plays with Phil Woods, you can tell that Phil is more of a modern type sound. But Benny Carter's sound is great, but it's not a real old vibrato sound, but it's got a more of a wide thing. And Artie Shaw music had a lot of vibrato, you know, in the sections. But we didn't use a wide vibrato. We did more of a fast vibrato. We do more of a slower vibrato. It's more of a modern sound. So people would comment and say, yeah, the music just sounds just like Artie Shaw. But it sounds different in a way. I said, well, it's because we interpret it differently. So that's, interpretation is infinite. So we're at Artie Shaw.
You stayed with Artie for 2 years.
Yeah, in that period. But we didn't go constantly, but we would go a lot. Take the bus out from Brockton, and we'd go out, you know, we'd drive to California on the way. We'd play all over the country. Interesting.
So you would come back here in between and
I was living at the Cape or my mom's house, my parents' house. Yes, I lived there. Then in 1987, my father said to me, "Hey Greg, you know there's a club in Hartford, the 880 Club, and the guy there brings in all guys and." I called up there trying to play, and I finally got to be brought up there as a guest. And I went, so I started to play more as a soloist, just getting my feet wet, like just getting to play with different guys, you know, and to get my name out, which is kind of hard to do. From there, then I asked Dick Johnson to do a quintet record with me. We did that. We did that together at Celebration, which I have those tapes somewhere. And also, I was starting to work with, I met Claudio Roditi at the 880 Club, and I asked him if he'd like to do something with me, and we did Spirit together. And then from then on, I started to, I had just gotten married again. I mean, it was my wife, I'm divorced now, but I mean, we have two boys, and right now they're 26 and 22. But we went to Quebec City for our honeymoon. And I said I wasn't bringing my horn. And she said, probably the only thing that she said to me that was really nice in 12 years we were married, she said, "Oh, bring your horn. Bring your horn." I said, "Oh, really? We're going on a honeymoon." I said, "No, just bring your horn." So I brought my horn. So we get to Quebec City, and there's a jazz club there. Clarendon Jazz Club, right in Old Town. And I brought my horn, and I went there the second night, and I brought my horn and asked if I could sit in, which I don't do anymore. But they said, sure. So I sat in, and then I got a gig there myself to go back. And so I started playing there like 3 nights at Quebec City. And then I met some friends and started playing in Montreal. Montreal was like good, and that brought me Montreal, playing there, got me to play in Rimouski Jazz Festival in Quebec, where I met someone from France that books the Vienne Festival in Vienne, France, which hired me to play there a couple of times. And then one night I'm driving to Montreal from Rhode Island in a blizzard because I had a gig, and I always go to my gigs and I didn't let the snowstorm stop me. It was like a horrible blizzard. And I made it there, and the doors were closed in the club, and everything was abandoned in Montreal down on St. Catherine Street. And I said, gee, well, and I saw a light on, and it was the bakery was open, so I went in and I said, I'm here tonight to play next door. I said, well, you know, just, oh, don't worry, you know, broken English, that they'll be here to plow you out. So they plowed the whole sidewalk up. I said, who's going to come out tonight? So finally, you know, an hour later, I don't know exactly the time frame, but it was a little bit later, and I went in, the band came in, the trio was there, I was playing. There was like three or four people in the place at the bar, just three guys. And we played like there was 100 people in the place, you know. And one of the guys calls me over and says, hey, you know, do you ever play in New York? I says, no, really not a lot, you know, not hardly at all at that time. He says, well, I produce with a guy records for Candid in England, Candid Records. He says, you think would you like to record for Candid? I can try to see what I can do. And I said, sure, why wouldn't I? So it took a year and a half or so before Alan Bates in England, here I am playing in England all the time now, and Alan Bates agreed. He says, well, why should I record him? There's a lot of good sax players out there. And the producer said, well, you know, because give him a record, let him do one. So they gave me one live in Birdland. So I showed up there in New York City. So I didn't know James Williams was on piano, Rufus Reed on bass, and Kenny Washington. So I walk in, and then we do a little rehearsal. And we record that album live, right off the cuff. I had some charts, and then the next night we played again, and we picked up. So that was the start of that Candid, which started my recording career, which is like the start of the 2 dozen leader things. See what I mean?
Just for the record here, the first couple were on a small, much smaller independent label. We believe one of them may even have been self-released by Greg, but we can't find it. But we're looking.
Yeah.
But Candid, for the record, was based in England, but that's like a legacy record company. Are you familiar with Candid from the 1950s?
No.
Well, it was home to a lot of modern jazz players when they had fallen out of favor with the major labels. So Mingus recorded extensively for Candid, Booker Irvin, James Moody, they did a lot of blues too, Otis Spann, excuse me. So it's a venerable label with international distribution, okay. And this is the beginning of Greg's real international major label career.
Yeah, I was thinking, you know, that really is spooky to me in a way, because, you know, I'm driving up to Montreal and like I'm thinking, well, if I hadn't gone there, I mean, would this have happened?
Mm, right.
I think that's
two things that could good that came out of the marriage then.
Yeah. And my two boys.
Four things. I find this to be a running commentary amongst our inductees who have made it big. You know, just not to get too far into it, I'll just mention a couple. Beaver Brown had been playing for a dozen years, were so popular that it seemed almost impossible that they hadn't been picked up. And their big break was the movie, but that was a coincidence. Mm-hmm. The guy who was producing
the
music.
Seems to be, that's the thing, the coincidence.
Yes, they have been looked at by everyone. At the bottom line, they had done radio broadcasts, they'd had a hit record. They had sold 10,000 copies of the original Wild Summer Nights.
Nice.
Still couldn't get a deal. But then the music producer for the motion picture said, we need a band like the one I heard at the bottom line last year.
Yeah.
And that was it. So
that's it.
And again, everyone, you know, Room Full of Blues happened to come to the attention of Doc Pomus, the great songwriter and producer. Mm-hmm. And he got them the Island Records deal. If you hadn't walked to Montreal, you might not have ever gotten that New York gig or met the guy from Candid and gone.
And then a dozen records later. Wow.
Unbelievable. Yeah. They recorded me three times.
Right.
Three records with them. I think it was that one and Straight Ahead with George Mraz and Clifton Ruiz, Claudio Roditi and Kenny Washington. And then the third one was Live at Chance with Richie Cole.
Yeah.
They produced that. And then from there, the distributor that was distributing Candid, they split. And then they started their own record company, DA Music in 1201, and they recorded me two or three times. And then I started to do other stuff, you know, it's like little smaller labels, you know.
But still with international distribution and international touring. Once you reach that level, your career is not going to go away, you know what I'm saying? He gets invited to play all over the world, festivals, colleges, teacher all over the world.
Yeah, teaching a lot more than, the festivals are a bit slow.
For everyone though.
You know. Think so?
Yeah. Festivals and stuff.
I don't want to say talk online, but I mean, talking about getting to New York, it's like hard to get back there to play. I don't know what it is. And I'm kind of playing. I'm not at my prime, but I think I'm getting pretty good at it. And as far as like better than I was 20 years ago. And I, you know, presentation and dealing with the audiences and just to engage, it's really a fun time, you know, it's not just like. Here I am, listen to me play. You know, it's like I'm playing music.
The thing about New York City, though, is there's very few venues anywhere, and there's a handful of them still exist in New York City, but there's 1,000 guys just in that city vying for those gigs.
A lot of competition.
And every other major player in the country is also vying for those gigs.
Right, it is true.
So you're not even in Manhattan, so you're part of the other 2,000 or 3,000 guys vying for those handful of gigs.
Yeah.
You know, if you can get one every 2 or 3 years, you'd be doing good.
Right. That's right. I was doing that for a while. It's tough in New York, though. Had one bad set, and now.
I was going to say, we've gone past or are right at about Rhode Island College.
Oh, Rhode Island College.
On the beginning of the development of their jazz curriculum.
Yo, they have the jazz band. By John Pellegrino was the director.
Yeah, I played in the jazz band when I was there, so it had a history. I was in the jazz band in 74, 75.
The history of jazz. That was the two things they had, history of jazz and the jazz band.
But there was no full curriculum.
No, in fact, what happened was somehow I was there doing a concert for John Pellegrino. He used to bring guest artists in to do it. I brought my group in with Artie Cabral and different guys, Bob Pitarudi, Artie Marco, and you know, and God rest his soul. It was like I was there, and some kids were there that were studying there, and they were really enthused about the gig. And they said, "Greg, you know, you could teach here. We'd love to take your class in jazz if you could." And so what happened was, 1999, they gave me a semester of the doing the big band. And I was teaching like jazz, you know, general jazz and talking about it. And then that semester ended, and then it was summertime, and there was no more talk about going back. And so I was like, man, I want to go back. So what happened was I went back and tried to get this in. And the chair at the time, he said, "Yeah, come on and see me, Greg. You know, come on and we'll talk about it." So I gather up a lot of my stuff, you know, my stuff that I've done and my reviews and stuff and that, and I go and teach, I go and see him, and I go into his office, and he's like, "Oh, okay, yeah, well, you know, you think, this is not a haven for people that want to teach, you know," stuff like that. The guy was a nice guy, but
do you remember who it was? The chair at the time?
Yeah, it's on.
It's up to you guys. I mean,
I don't know if I want to say.
If he doesn't want to say, we should make him.
Okay.
I can tell you.
Well, it's later.
Okay.
Yeah, write it down.
Alright. But anyway, I'm in there, and it goes south, you know. I'm astonished that he said no. He didn't want to support me. He didn't want me to teach there. And I said, I really have something to offer. I mean, I really, I embrace the jazz form, and I do this. I know how to do it. Everybody wants to teach that plays well. They think, well, we can't just have people come in. So I said, okay. So I left, and I closed the door. And as I closed the door, another door opened up, and the guy comes out and says, "Greg, what's happening?" I said, "Oh, Dick, how are you?" He says, "Yeah, I'm good. I mean, you know, I love hearing your gigs, man. You know, what's happening?" I told him the story. So he says, "Come with me." So he takes me to see the dean. And he says, you know, to tell him the story of what happened. And the dean says, "Oh, really?" He says, "Let's take a walk." So we walk back, and we're walking down the campus, and me and Dick and
Dick,
the dean.
Dick Lupino?
No, Dick Keel. He's retired now. He's a fan of mine. He was a fan of mine before I even went there. So the dean got wind of it, and he went, and we saw the chair in the campus walking outside. And all he said to him was, "Oh, do you have an objection with Greg teaching here? Do you have an objection?" And the guy looked at him and says, "No, I don't have any problem with that."
Yep.
And that was it.
And this became the start of the Rhode Island College jazz
curriculum. Yeah, and then 2 years later, Robert Elam, who is the guy that was there before, he left.
Yes.
I like that guy a lot. He helped me form, he wanted to form a jazz minor program. And we wrote it up as four combos a semester, four combos for a person to take, and that would be, and then a jazz theory course, two semesters, and four semesters of private lessons, and then jazz history, and you get a jazz minor degree.
Huh.
And that's still intact.
Wow.
So I've been there since 2000 doing this.
You were very instrumental, obviously, if you wrote the curriculum for the minor. And then did you help choose the other instructors? Like Jimmy C. Abra and...
Yeah, I suggested people. Yeah.
It's quite a department.
I didn't know that.
It's impressive.
Yeah. Oh, you know about it. Yeah.
Oh, sure. You know, I'm very, very close friends with Gypsy Abra and others that teach up there. And I graduated from, I shouldn't say that, I never technically got my degree, but I completed my music, the degree program at Rhode Island College.
Okay.
So I know all the people you're talking about, Bob Elam. And,
that's great. Bob's gone now. I don't know where he
is.
Florida.
Well, I think he might have passed away.
Really?
I think so.
Really?
I'm
I thought he lived
sure.
in Florida.
We'll take that out. I thought somebody told me he passed away. My wife's father used to play with Bob Elam in the 50s.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bob, he was really into the music and the jazz. He was a supporter. And he always came up with the budget. He said, "You want to do something, Greg? We'll put it together. I can get you this much." Yeah. He was always there. He was a big guy. I'm trying to think of what else I was going to say about it, but I can't remember.
You know, I'm a teacher myself, and I'm interested in your approach to teaching jazz. When you get a new student, you know, who might be a little green, how do you go about instructing that person?
Well, we got to see what they're about first, how they play, and what their attitude is. Like, I just had a new student the other day play guitar, and like, he knows what he wants to learn, and he knows what he needs to learn, and I'm trying to help him. So when you get a student like that, it's easier. But I like to be able to find their weaknesses about what they need to do, and try to build their strengths on that. And I go slowly, you know, try to say like, do this, but do it like really slowly for like a month or so, and then do it in different keys. But you have to put the time in. I say you can't just do it. Like, you're not do it again. You have to do it and keep doing it, you know? And then you build your momentum up. But you always have those building blocks that you have to go back and reshape to keep them fresh so you can, because those are important to have those in your vocabulary and under your fingers.
Mm-hmm.
So then you can always use that for as a strength to do the stuff that's, you know, more fun.
So you don't just teach your instrument. There is a guitar player who came to you.
Oh, I have vibes student. I have a flute player. I work on harmony on piano chords, and I do I show how to write bass lines and compose and improvise and also arrange.
So it is possible to teach a guitar player to read, sight read. It is possible, for the record.
Yeah, but I've got a guitar player. This is the only guy that. he blew me away. We played like Forest Flower, and and he actually could read with a nice sound. Huh. All the other students I've ever had a guitar in my combo. He said, "Oh, Greg, I can't read notes, but I can read the chords a little bit." I said, "Well, why did you ever have a teacher? Don't you know how to read like scales?
Notation, yeah.
And I don't know how to make the rhythms."
But this fellow can sight read it as well.
Yeah, he's good. Yeah. He's sight.
My teachers would have batted me in the head, you know.
Yeah. Guitar?
Yeah, I had good teachers. Vinnie Fiatella, Carl Belmont, John Cudini.
Carl Belmont, did he have a music store?
Yeah, downtown.
Yeah. Carl Stiggins?
No, that was a record store. Oh. He had a music store. Northeast Music or something like that. It was right next to Axelrod's. But he had a different clientele. Oh. He sold Marshall amps and Sun amps and it was a more rock and roll clientele.
Well, what a nice history.
He was a great, but it was all about reading. You know, started, you were using those Mickey Mayer books and studying the Berkeley books and stuff.
Wow.
I'm surprised that kids aren't being made to read.
Yeah, that's important. You know, he can just play chords and not really. But he even told me, he says, you know, it's hard for me to know the guitar function. He's trying to learn how the guitar works because he has trouble like playing a line in one position and then playing
different position. Yeah, there's several positions with 22
You can
frets.
Do like da 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 da. You can do that, but the scales are hard to maneuver to run. Because like if you're playing a C here and you got to go to a B, what B do you go to because of what's following it?
Yeah.
That's what he's. So I'm trying to get him a teacher to do that there. And, you know.
Huh, interesting.
Where are we now?
I don't know.
We are basically at the present because I'm in between your website and my record collection. You have had a fabulous career since the early 90s that just is continuing and is... The icing on the cake is Rhode Island College and his work as an educator. He travels all over the world teaching. If he goes to play in Russia,
he
goes to the university and teaches there during the day.
Well, sometimes,
and then they come to see him at night.
Yeah, I do that occasionally in England a lot.
I've seen that video,
That was a music store. That's the one I'm doing a video for again this time.
Okay.
We're going to do it on an improvisation idea. I sort of worked out something that will be formative. I know it can talk about some specific things.
Huh.
That was just like get up and talk and play. You know, and I was get off the plane. I was pretty shattered. It was a night flight. I got in there in the morning real early. Took a train and then went in front of the camera in the morning. But I'm going to England. I play at some schools and teach during the day, two or three times maybe when I go, and then like I get that gig in Poland coming up in March for a week in Krakow.
It's pretty heavy stuff.
Krakow.
So no plans to retire or anything like that. Your career is on a roll. You know, it seems to still be in an upward swing. You just got 4 stars at Downbeat for his previous release.
It's great, you are at the top of your field. Yeah, but don't think that it's like easy.
No, I don't.
they try to get gigs is tough, especially without an agent, you know. That's really bothers me not to have an agent that could have some clout, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is.
Huh.
But the experiences with Phil Woods has been great. You know, that was meeting him and having the approval of him saying that he liked playing with me and he enjoyed the energy and the passion of my playing was really a great compliment coming from him.
Huh.
And that's another thing. See, I called him and asked him if he'd like to do something with me sometime. And he said, I know who you are. I sent him some stuff and he said, man, that's swinging. And I asked him right out. I said, what do you think of that, Phil? So they said, oh man, it's a swing. And he said, I like it. But I said, when I asked him to play, he said, he's quite expensive. I said, well, I mean, what you want to record the first album? So we did that and got that together. And then the second album, he was much more reasonable. And we did some gigs together through the country, you know, Philly, Cleveland, and Boston, and, you know, and it was a great experience, you know. That's the Phil Wood School of Music. Unbelievable.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I learned so much from just playing with him. It's incredible what I still have in my head about that. You know, it's just, I can't believe that. But I always admired him, you know, and I never called him because I felt inadequate. Because I always felt like, well, maybe I shouldn't, you know. It's gonna, you know.
It might be the secret to his great success. He's still seeking.
Still seeking.
Still wanting to learn.
Learn. I was going to say that.
You know.
Still learning even
after
all these experiences.
I have so much I want to do. I know what I want to do, but sometimes I'll just sit here by myself and I'll just space out and look out outside and just sit here like, you know, like you guys are here, but I'm cats over there. I'm sitting here and my horn's over there and I just play it over there. But I don't have that drive like to just say, I got to just go dig in. I've lost a lot of that dig in because I'm kind of burnt out with having to ask things. I said, no, I think if they want me, they'll ask me. But my girlfriend, Perry, says, you know, you got to keep pushing out there.
Unfortunately, that's the business these days. It's not.
Yeah, it's changed.
It's not even the 70s, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Those were probably the last easy good times. Well, we still had the Paul's Mall. We still had two or three jazz clubs here in Providence.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Jazz Workshop.
Yeah. But even beyond that, you know, even beyond Rhode Island things.
At every town had
marketing
at least
one, that one song
yes.
on your MP3.
Yes. Yeah.
I got something to say though, because if somebody listens to this, a student or somebody. Like, I think that I could be more along right now if I had done this, put more time into practicing in the earlier days, and maybe learn to deal with people differently and not be introvert or to be, you know, do drugs or to be out of it and think it's cool. Like, wasted a lot of time that I could have been, maybe if I was like I am now, I'm more relaxed with things. Seems like you attract more because your head's clear, and I think people pick up on your vibe.
Yeah.
That was the era you came up in, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that's when jazz hit its second commercial peak with, you know.
You know, it's like talking to Rick's like talking to Yoda, you know what I mean?
Hey, that's a good place to end it.
Okay.
All right, it's Yoda, Bellaire, and Al.
I'm just saying, you know, if you go to Berkeley now, you will actually get courses in the music business.
You do.
There was no such thing as that at music schools in the 60s and 70s.
Yeah.
These things are new to the curriculum.
Yeah.
But also, the thing about, you know, being professional is like returning phone calls and like make sure that you follow up with someone and mean what you say. And if you can't mean what you say, gee, you know, I was speaking a little bit quickly. I don't think I really can do that.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
I mean, and, I find that students today try to instill that thing about the business. And you know, you think that they know what you think, but they're younger. There's no way, when you talk to someone, you can't think that they know what you're talking about.
Can't assume, right?
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
Well you've done. Oh, yeah. I'm sorry.
I'm gonna say thank you very much and hit the stop button. You
know, still time for a chicken leg.
Ah!
I gotta hit the head and get going.
All right. Well, thank
you
very much.
Take a chicken leg to the other way home.
No.
Thank you very much, Greg.
Thank you very much, Alan and Rick. How about a chicken leg?
Ah! I'll take it with me.
All right.